Tynecastle Park, where victory this afternoon would take Celtic to the top of the Bells Premier Division for the first time in more than a year. Hearts, though, out to complete the double over Tommy Burns' side after defeating them in the Coca-Cola Cup last month. Good afternoon to you. Hearts against Celtic, the whole match live and exclusive, coming your way in less than, what, half an hour's time. Joining me here in the studio, Hearts club captain Craig Levine, fighting back to fitness after long-term injury, and Jim Traynor, sports editor of the Daily Express. The big match, live, and so much more. After the week from hell, Gaza responds in style. But Aberdeen produce an even better comeback. Another goalkeeper sees red, Jim Leighton off for the first time in his career. But Motherwell don't take advantage. The heat's off Alex Totten as Kilmarnock get their first home win of the season. And a topsy-turvy weekend in the first division as the leading three all lose. Yes, good action. All the Premier goals coming up. But first, let's join Jim Delahunt at Tynecastle. And I believe he's with Jim Jeffries. Jim, over to you.
Yeah, thanks very much, Jim. Welcome to Tynecastle. Great atmosphere building up in the stadium. Just 28, 29 minutes to kick off. We've got some team news. Celtic, no Andreas Tom. He's on the bench today. Remember, he was an injured out beforehand. And Hearts give a debut to Stuart Callaghan, who comes in for the injured Neil McCann. And as you said, Jim Jeffries is with me now. Tell us about Stuart Callaghan. Where can we expect him to play, Jim?
Yes, he'll play wide left. You know, we've been playing well the last couple of games, and you know, it was a blow to lose McCann last week, and after a good game at Easter Road. So Stuart's a natural left winger, and he can go in there and keep the balance of the side right. You know, he's been here 3 or 4 years, and he's been in the reserves, and it was like the situation with Richie and McManus in that last year. I think, you know, they need to have a new goal, and it's just been long enough, and he's getting a chance, so hopefully the young boy will take it with every confidence that he will.
Apart from McCann, everybody fitting well and looking forward to it?
Yes, two big games now. Today we can obviously get ourselves into fourth position in the league today, and then we've got the semi-final to look forward to. But it'll be a hard game today, and it should be an exciting match.
And I know you were widely quoted last week as talking about giving Stuart Kerr a hard time earlier on. Is that still the battle plan?
Well, when any goalkeeper comes in, he'll be anxious to do well. He's a good goalkeeper, we know that. But we've got to get put him under pressure. We've got to get crosses in there, but we've also got to put him under pressure with challenging at these crosses. And then, as I say, that's one of the reasons Callaghan's in as well. He's a good crosser of the ball, so hopefully he'll get on it today and get quality crossing, and then we'll test Stuart Kerr out.
Dave McPherson was on one of our programmes the other night, and he suggested the big thing for Hearts was to get ahead of Hibs in the league table, but there's more to it than that, surely.
Oh yes, I mean, you know, we want to finish as high as possible. I mean, we came with a great run last year, and you know, but we're better off this year as we are at this time. We were going into this, I remember the current fixture last year at this time was Falkirk. We lost and went bottom of the league. Well, that's not going to happen, so there's been a big change. We've got ourselves into, we've got ourselves at the top half of the league, just got picked with Aberdeen and goal difference. So we're looking to finish and have a close the gap on Rangers and Celtic as well.
Great. Hope you have a good day today, Jim. And that's it from Tynecastle at the moment. Back to Jim in the studio.
Thanks, Jim. Jim's everywhere. Well, after giving Rangers their first defeat of the season, Hibs caretaker boss Jockey Scott was looking for more of the same. Now, the Fir Park fans gave manager Alec McLeish a great reception after he pledged his future to Motherwell, but he could easily have been in the other dugout for this one. But the Hibs hot seat is still vacant.
Hibs caretaker boss Jockey Scott is a candidate to be Alec Miller's full-time replacement. His players do seem anxious to please. What a strike here from Kevin Harper to give the visitors the lead on 7 minutes. Harper pouncing on Van der Gag's error to thunder home 1-0 Hibs. Motherwell had a great chance to equalise when defender Brian Martin tried to beat Leighton with an overhead kick. He almost did, but not quite. A sign of hope for Big Alec there. Then a moment of folly from Hibs' Jim Leighton. John Henry racing in on goal. The striker's brought down, Leighton's the last man, and he handles the ball outside the box. Despite his protests, referee Fleming had no option, the red card. A real panic now for Jockey Scott. No substitute goalkeeper for Hibs, so defender Andy Millen took over the number one jersey. All sorts of problems for Millen and company now. Pat McGinley's wild attempt at a clearance was half cleared by Millen, and that gave Fraser Wishart the perfect chance, but instead McGinley cleared up his own mess. 1-0 to 10-man Hibs at half-time, and in the second half, Motherwell kept bombarding the replacement goalkeeper, Dougie Arnott rattling the crossbar. The 10 men held out until the 73rd minute, A rapid-fire move which was just too much for the defence, finished off by Sean McSkimming. One goal apiece. And a great finish there from McSkimming. The header across the goal from Alex Burns, and McSkimming gets his third goal of the season to help Motherwell take a point.
Well, Dundee United are still smarting from being pipped to the Division 1 title by Dunfermline last season. They travelled to East End Park looking for revenge. The Fifers, though, were looking for a boost before facing Rangers in the Cup semi on Tuesday. This was a first half which both sides will want to forget. The only chance came Dunfermline's way. Petrie played it in, it fell to Alan Moore, and that wasn't far away. But that was it from the first 45 minutes. Thankfully, things improved after the break. Robbie Winters had a goal from long range there. But Zoran Lemichik's goal saved from that. United struck first blood though, and they did it in the 65th minute. Great work on the wing from substitute Andy McLaren. He gets round Denbeeman there, played it in, and Winters did the rest. United one up. In replay, McLaren did so well, and a good cross and a good finish from Winters. And then McLaren caused more problems for the Pars. He set up Winters again. Lemichik came to meet him, and United should have capitalised there. But Dunfermline got level. From the corner, Andy Todd headed home. Just when it looked like United might win this match, the Pars were right back in it. Todd always a danger in the air, a good leap and a good finish from him, and that sets him up nicely for the meeting with Rangers this week. 1-1 it finished. All right, now to Rugby Park, where Kilmarnock met Raith Rovers. Both teams desperate for points as they languish at the foot of the table.
Raith Rovers certainly didn't hang about at Rugby Park yesterday. Kevin Twaddle did some damage on the wing. And what about that for a header? Tony Rougier giving Ian Munro's men the lead with only 2 minutes gone. The Trinidad international is performing the aerial acrobatics to finish superbly. Killy nil, Raith 1. The Kilmarnock defence had a very nervy first half and the fans were far from happy. Things almost get worse when Twaddle beat the offside trap. Deary me, Twaddle's look says it all. Alex Totten none too happy either. Raith Rovers had their new goalkeeper in the lineup, ex-Rangers reserve Colin Scott, who deals well here with Ali Mitchell's effort. So Kilmarnock coming back into this game and Rovers finding it increasingly difficult to keep them at bay. The Fifers didn't clear their lines properly here, and that allowed Anderson to fire the 20-yarder. Scott can't hold it, and Tom Brown gets the equaliser, 1-1 with 36 minutes gone. Perhaps Colin Scott could have done better here, but Tom Brown doesn't pass up the chance. Killy secured their first home league win of the season 13 minutes into the second half. The long ball coming up now from Billy Finlay, met by Paul Wright. He does well. It's in the net, he thinks, but he just comes back to follow up and make sure. 2-1 to Kilmarnock. Another look at that one, Finlay with the through ball. Paul Wright has a look, the little flick over the keeper, and he just runs in to make sure. Killy take the points.
Okay, more Premier Division action, highlights from the First Division and the latest news from Tynecastle as we build up to kick-off. Remember, Hearts against Celtic live, all coming your way after this short break.
I think I'll drive to work today. Mrs. Jones.
Fine. Mr. Jones. We could be we could be we could be you and I forever. We could be yeah, we could be lifting it up to new horizons, lifting
Good morning, Mr. Jones.
Good morning, Mrs. Jones.
VFit is the only yogurt containing the live LGG culture. VFit, it's full of life.
What time is it?
Miller Time's back.
Thanks for coming on the show.
My pleasure.
With more beer.
I love Miller Pilsner because of its clean, easy taste.
More bribes.
I love Miller Pilsner because they paid me to say I do.
More stars.
James Bond.
More girls.
Kathy Lloyd.
And a talking dog.
Good boy.
Miller Time, Wednesday night with Kathy Lloyd. See press for details.
Ouch.
Get a free 11-pound load tumble dryer when you buy this Tricity automatic washing machine. Yes, both for only $399.99. Glenn's, Hutchison, Robertson's, and Stepegg.
Sterling, where the past meets the present. Out of doors or undercover. Endless pursuits, exciting sights. One visit will bring you back to Sterling again and again. Sterling is Braveheart Country.
So what's Rome like?
Everyone kisses.
Hmm?
Couples kiss, waiters kiss. Even the statues are at it.
Oh, do try not to join in.
The thing is, Kath, I miss you. You didn't pack my blue socks, did you?
Pack yourself next time.
How's it there?
That feels funny. Too, tidy. How's work?
They're terrible. They like me. They want me to stay another week.
Oh. Oh, that's great.
I'm in the most romantic city in the world. And you're not with me.
Yes, I am.
With Cellnet, you can make and receive calls in over 50 countries around the world. That's more than any other UK network.
Yeah, that Rangers game coming up in a minute, but about 15 minutes away now from kickoff at Tynecastle. Remember, Heart Celtic Live. Let's go back through there now, where Jim Delahunt is with Celtic boss Tommy Burns. Jim.
Yeah, thanks very much, Jim. Welcome back to Tynecastle. Of course, the added incentive for Celtic today is that they can go top of the table if they win. Added incentive, but is that added pressure, Tommy?
Well, it doesn't make any difference, Jim. It's a game that we know we've got to go and try and win it. And that's exactly what we're here to do.
Andreas Thom only on the substitutes bench. Why is that?
Well, Andy's actually been injured for the last 3 weeks. He's only trained the last couple of days, but the fact that he's pain free, would allow him to go on and maybe take part at some stage in the game.
Yeah. Now, I think I'm right in saying, Tommy, that everybody at Celtic will be in a better frame of mind for this visit to Tynecastle than the last one.
Well, I think you'd be perfectly right, Nacho.
You don't want to elaborate that on that at all?
No, I think that is best forgotten.
Absolutely. Everybody fitting well today, Tommy?
Yeah, they're fine, and just as I say, just look forward to the game.
And looking forward to going top if you can win.
Well, that's a nice wee bonus, Jim.
You've not really committed yourself to much there, Tommy, but anyway, back to the studio and Jim.
Tommy Burns playing a strange game there. Well, Paul Gascoigne is no stranger to pressure, but yesterday's game must have been his most tense ever. Scandals on and off the park saw the midfield star under the microscope for all the wrong reasons. The fallen idol faced the music from the 50,000 fans he'd let down so badly. But he responded positively, but Aberdeen had the last laugh at Ibrox. Okay, so let's now see the highlights of Rangers against Aberdeen. It looked so likely that Rangers would win this one, having gone two up, but this is how it finished. Rangers against Aberdeen from Ibrox. Aberdeen striker Scott Booth made his first start to the domestic season, having missed the opening eight games through injury. Kiriakov's cross, and it gave him a great chance. Snelders did just enough. After a week he'd like to forget on and off the park, there was a great deal of pressure on Gascoigne to do something special. He took the 1-2 here from George Alberts. He got round Irvine, but not Nicky Walker. And then Gascoigne was barged off the ball to give Rangers this free kick. And what a free kick it was. And it's even better in replay. A tremendous opening goal from Gascoigne. And then Laudrup took over. Straight from the halfway line, he took on the Dons defence himself. Walker could do nothing. Rangers, two up. And at that stage, you had to fancy them to win this match. Another great run and finish from Brian Laudrup. So what would the Dons do? Well, their answer was positive enough. Joe Miller pushed forward. A mistake from Goff, and Brian Irvine brought Aberdeen right back into this match. 2-1. Rangers caught cold here. Goff won't want to see this again, but a good finish from the Aberdeen defender. Into the second half, and the Dons pushing forward again. Joe Miller with a thunderbolt free kick. Schnelders did just enough to keep it out. And then a moment of real controversy in this match. Kiriakov plays it in. Dodds round Moore. Was he brought down inside the penalty area? Dodds certainly thought so. So did Roy Aiken. In replay, judge for yourself. He got away. Maybe he made the most of it. But Aberdeen were the more positive side. Svetinov with the cross. It fell to Booth. And again, the ex-Aberdeen goalkeeper to the rescue for Rangers. But here in the dying moments of this match, Durant barged Svetinov, and this proved to be crucial. Miller with the free kick, Irvine headed down, and Billy Dodds with his 17th goal of this season. 2-2, and certainly Aberdeen deserved the draw. A great leap at the back post by Irvine, and Dodds equalised. Rangers threw it away. So, Rangers now lead the Bells Premier Division by 3 points, but Celtic will go top on goal difference if they win today. Victory for Hearts, though, would move them into fourth place above capital rivals Hibs. So the big question is this, can Celtic win and go top? Well, Craig, you obviously hope not. You want a Hearts win today?
Looking for a Hearts win and looking for a good game.
Yeah.
The last game, the cup tie, was very exciting, and I hope today's game will be much the same.
And what about yourself? You're still trying to get back to fitness after the cruciate ligament operation.
That's right, it's been a long, drawn-out saga. I had another operation about nearly 3 months ago.
Mm.
But the way things are looking just now, it'll be another 7 or 8 months before I'm back playing.
So it's a long struggle for you, Craig, at the moment. Well, we're glad to have you here. Jim, what about the Hearts lineup today? We heard from Jim Jeffries earlier on. Do you feel that they are capable of winning and going into fourth spot?
Well, you've got to say they're capable of winning because they've already done it to Celtic in the Coca-Cola Cup. But I think much depends on how they treat Celtic's goalkeeper, Kerr.
Yeah.
It's his first start. And if you remember what Mark Hatley did to Michael Watt at Aberdeen, really punished them, threatened them. I think Hearts have got to do that. They've got to have a presence in his box. They've got to make sure and frighten this young keeper.
Yeah.
And if they play Callahan wide on the left, the debutant, I mean, Craig's saying that he's a great crosser of the ball. So I think that's obviously the intention.
Let's see that team then, Craig. Jim is mentioning Callahan there. Let's see the Hearts lineup. Now, what do you think? You're quite happy about that. Stefan Pai is in today, Frenchman with a lot of experience.
Yeah, I can see exactly what the manager's doing there. I think it'll be a 4-4-2 with Callahan wide on the left-hand side, getting into forward areas. Mainly to pick out Stefan Pai in the middle, and John Robertson, as usual, will be sniffing about to pick up anything that drops off
the
goalkeeper.
Jim, exactly. Now, Jim, you mentioned Stuart Kerr in goal. Let's have a look at the Celtic lineup. It's a big day for him, but, I mean, Pat Bonner rates him highly.
Yes, I mean, he wouldn't be in the team if they didn't think he was ready, but I think because of the suspension, obviously, it may well turn out to be a blessing in disguise for Tommy Burns, because I think he's wanted to try him all along but wasn't quite sure.
Yeah.
And you know, you destroy Marshall's confidence if you drop him for a young kid.
Yes.
So he's got the perfect opportunity now.
Well, it's got all the makings of being an interesting match. Well, if you've got a point to make about the match at Tynecastle this afternoon or any other matter, you can call the ScotSport Forum on 0500 404 000. The lines are open now and the calls are ever free. As ever, are free. Well, now, Division 1 in Scotland is proving to be as tight as ever. This weekend highlighted that as the top three teams all suffered defeat. Here's the story then of Dundee Thistle and Falkirk against St Johnstone from David Tanner.
At Brockville, in a battle of horrible strips, St Johnstone almost took an early lead. Roddy Grant hitting the post that time. At the other end, Peter Furr gave the ball away to Falkirk's Brian Hamilton, and he teed up Derek Ferguson. And the home side take the lead. 17 minutes gone, and that's vintage Fergie. A first-class strike from the former Rangers, Hearts and Sunderland man, his first for the Bairns. 1-0 Falkirk. That'll give him a real boost. He's been struggling with injury for much of his 12-month spell at Brockville. Now here's another chance for Ferguson, 12 minutes later, and it's another goal, 2-0 to the Bairns. Fergie does it again, but look at the wicked deflection that carries the ball past Alan Main in the St Johnstone goal. But it counts, it's 2-0. Things get worse for Paul Sturrock's men. Philip Scott sent off in the second half after a clash with Jamie McGowan. 2-0. At Dens Park, Partick Thistle were looking to follow up their 6-0 defeat of East Fife with another win. And what a great start for them. David Moss pushes them ahead. 10 minutes on the clock. Jared Stirling fired in the cross. It hits off Kevin Bain. And David Moss puts the loose ball away. 1-0 the Jags. Into the second half now, and things getting worse for Jim Duffy's men. The Jags' second goal, a carbon copy of the first one, really. It's Stirling, Moss, and Thistle really motoring. They race into the lead 2-0. The Dundee defence doing their impersonation of a Rolling Stone. They gather no Moss, and David Moss puts them 2-0 up. Two goals and plenty of puns.
Ah, David. Well, we're now just minutes away from kickoff at Tynecastle. Hearts against Celtic. And good luck to those who'll be reporting on this match as part of the Young Journalist of the Year competition. The whole match live coming up in just a couple of minutes' time.
Dear Volkswagen, my husband and I have recently divorced, and as my part of the settlement, I had our new Volkswagen Golf, which my ex-husband assured me cost £13,000. Now, thanks to one of your advertisements, I've discovered it only cost £10,860. I always thought Volkswagens were expensive. Now I know differently and have acted accordingly. Yours gratefully, Caroline Napier.
BT is offering free connection to an 0800 number, but frankly, is it really worth having?
This is a company that believes that shoes have things to say.
And Camper doesn't hit the fashion set, which is so fickle anyway.
Why should the 0800 number be so appealing?
The whole point of this campaign was to include a channel for people to be able to talk to us.
It does allow us to expand our customer base.
Why do they respond to the 0800 number?
The ad catches their eye, and when they see the 0800 number, it costs them nothing. The response has been absolutely phenomenal. We're not blindly advertising. It allows customers all over the UK to get in touch with us and speak to a human being.
For free connection to BT's 0800 service, call 0800 800 800 today. Be smart, BT.
But suppose you didn't have your own pension, Grandpa?
Well, it would be a bit like being up a creek without a paddle.
Don't waste hundreds of pounds on expensive carpet. Simply buy two small pieces, attach them to the bottom of your feet, and get that quality carpet feel throughout your home. This money-saving tip was brought to you by McDonald's, where a Big Mac, medium fries, and a medium soft drink will cost you just £2.88.
Rent an automatic washing machine for only £3.49 a week, or a fridge freezer only £3.29 a week at Glen's, Hutchison, Robertson's, and Steppec.
Through Verilux No Line bifocal lenses, your favourite things look great at any distance. Distance, no object. Available at your nearest or furthest Verilux opticians.
There are many different ways to communicate, but usually
the simplest are the most effective. So at Nokia, we make it as easy as possible for you. Nokia, connecting people.
Again, Hearts Celtic coming your way in just a couple of minutes from now. Craig, we mentioned him earlier, but John Robertson no doubt will be a key man this afternoon. Robertson, who scores so many crucial goals for your club.
He will be a key man. I can't remember the amount of times that we've won games by the odd goal and John's been responsible for that. It just seems to be, he has this knack that Van Hooijdonk's got as well. Alan McCoy's got to be in the right place at the right time.
Yeah.
I think Jim, Craig, if we see him, the other thing about John Robertson is that he's got this ability to place the ball in the net, even when he's under immense pressure. I think that's one of his gifts, actually.
You're right, Jim. He doesn't fluster, does he?
No, he very rarely misses the target. And a lot of the time you'll see when he scores, it's in a corner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But a lot of the time as well, if you watch John opts for power a lot of time as well. Mm-hmm. John isn't one of these guys that every time the ball comes to him, he'll look for a corner. He does go for power. What he does do, and you've said correctly, he does hit the target.
Yeah, I think that's crucial for a striker. Yeah. I mean, Van Hooijdonk's the same, isn't he?
Van Hooijdonk, now, you're mentioning him there, Jim. How are things between him and Celtic now? Is it all calmed down, do you think?
Well, I think Celtic fans would love to think so when you see him score goals like that, but I don't think so. I think that relationship between Van Hooijdonk and Tommy Burns, Van Hooijdonk and Fergus McCann, the club and player, in fact, I think that relationship is shot, it's gone.
Yeah.
I think too many silly words have been said, and I don't think they'll ever repair that. And I think it's a case of they need him, he needs to play, but I think you'll see Van Hooijdonk moving on.
I just wish that fallout had lasted a little bit longer so he wasn't playing today.
Yeah, because no doubt, I mean, he could turn into a key player this afternoon.
He'll score goals the same as John, a very similar type of player. Yeah. There's a chance he scores goals. Well, he'll be a danger to us today.
We mentioned Stéphane Pie, of course, Craig. Now, the other Frenchman, of course, is Gilles Rousset. Yeah. He may be under a fair bit of pressure because Celtic will come out positively today, won't they?
He certainly will. He's been a revelation. He's been our best signing, I think. Manager got him on a free transfer, didn't pay any money for him. Now he's had a chance to move elsewhere, and you can see looking at these saves, he's just an exceptional goalkeeper.
Yeah, he's been a bargain, hasn't he? But mm-hmm. You've got Hearts have got problems, I think. I mean, I think they conceded 14 goals so far or something.
I don't know, to be honest with you.
I think they've given away, well, not given away, but they've conceded 14, and Van Hooijdonk's the very person if the service is correct. But then Tom's not playing, as we've heard, because of the injury, and I think he's a crucial loss for Celtic. He's a very clever, intelligent player just off the front.
And the man with the white boots, Craig Di Canio, he's going to feature. You can't keep him down. I mean, he's such a favourite with the Celtic support.
Another exceptional player, great ability, but I think if we can close him down and hopefully stop the service into him, which I think Andy Tom would have probably been able to give him, he's not playing today, so we can hopefully we can limit his service, then we'll stop him from doing what he does best, which is beating people, scoring goals or creating goals for other players.
Yes. You know, Jim, we may look back in this game at the end of the season as being one of the most crucial matches of the season, because what a confidence boost it would give Burns and Celtic to go top.
There's absolutely no doubt about that, Jim. I mean, if Celtic can go here, albeit in goal difference, they're on top of Rangers. Rangers are supposed to win 9 in a row. I mean, the bookies make them favourites for that. But if you look at Rangers' recent results, not just the scorelines, but the way they've lost. Mm. They've been in front, they've lost both those games. Things are beginning to go wrong there. The defence is falling apart, you have to say. And the number of goals they've lost from set pieces and aerial threat that they're not dealing with is astonishing. It's alarming for Walter Smith. So Tommy Burns knows this, Celtic know that. And if they can go to the top of the league this evening, that's a great psychological boost.
It would indeed be great.
Yeah, I think so. But one point I would like to make, two or three games ago when Rangers beat Celtic, the season was over for Celtic, wasn't it, if you listen to a lot of people?
That's right.
So I don't think this game is that crucial in the fact that that's the Celtic top
but
of the league.
But just simply, simply for that psychological edge that would give Celtic, there they are, they would be on top.
I understand that.
But I don't recall too many people saying it was over for Celtic.
No, but I remember it after reading two or three newspapers.
You're reading the wrong newspaper.
I've told you that 100 times.
What is the mood, Craig, these days at Tynecastle, Craig? I mean, Jim Jeffries has done well. We spoke about Rousset there. He seemed to appear from nowhere and has been extremely influential. What about the other foreigners? He's done very well in the market, hasn't he?
Very, very well. I don't know who the guy is who's supplying these players, but He's bought Rousset. I think Stephen Pye looks if he'll be a very good player. Stefano Salvatore.
Yeah.
He's fitted in exceptionally well, and he's the type of player we've been looking for, somebody with a bit of guts in the middle of the park who can win tackles and play the ball simple and keep a hold of the ball for us.
Yeah, indeed. Jeffries has done extremely well since he went to Tynecastle, Jim.
I think he's an excellent manager. I thought he did very well at Falkirk also. I like his outlook in football. I like the way he tries to play. And he proves, again, with these signings we've been talking about, that it's not necessary to go and find £7 million from somewhere to find a class player.
Exactly.
You can find them if you look in the right place.
They are there if you look in the right spot. Yeah. We're going to Tynecastle in just a minute. Kick-off delayed there this afternoon, but not for long, let me tell you. Jim, let me put you in the spot then. I mean, we've emphasised the importance of this match for both sides, but who are you going to take, do you think, today?
I think Celtic will win. I think they sense they've come through a bad period with the Van Hooijdonk controversy, and I think that that's settled down slightly. I think that Celtic sense an advantage can begin to here, and I really don't see Hearts stopping them today.
Right. Craig, obviously you're going to take umbrage
at that. I'm going to disagree on Leonard.
Do you think Hearts are good enough to go out there and put in a good performance over 90 minutes and beat Celtic today?
I think the team that we're playing today is better than the team that beat Celtic in the cup tie, and take from that what you will.
Yeah. And Craig, let's just go over that again. At the moment, you are looking at what, a return possibly around April? I mean, you obviously want to feature in this season for Hearts.
That's right.
But it must be immensely frustrating for you when you see the team doing pretty well.
The team that we have now has improved out of all recognition since I last played. I don't know exactly how many players are still playing that played in the last team that I played in. But the standard that we have now is far better than we had then.
And what about your own confidence, Craig? Does that get affected? Because when you're out for such a lengthy period of time, it must hit you pretty hard.
My confidence, I'll find out about that when I go back playing.
Craig Brown, only a couple of weeks ago when we were over there on World Cup duty, he was still talking about you as possibly playing a crucial role in the three defender system that he's trying to use. Is that a possibility? I mean, is that a realistic target for you to get back into that World Cup squad?
My aim is to get back playing in the Hearts team.
Well, let's hope that you do get back, Craig. There it is, the Celtic huddle. Jerry McNee is the match commentator this afternoon, and with him is Charlie Nicholas. Jerry.
Welcome, everyone, to Tynecastle. Another match of huge importance. Everyone's talking about Celtic possibly going top ahead of Rangers and goal difference, but any Hearts win puts them in fourth place ahead of Hibernian on goal difference and just a point behind third place Aberdeen. So most of the people in this stadium certainly looking towards a Hearts win this afternoon. And as Craig Lean was saying there, there's no doubt the midfield has had a tremendous lift from Stefano Salvatore's arrival, and the midfield was superb in the recent match against Hibs. There's Jim McCluskey, the match referee, hugely experienced, and Peter Grant in a hurry to get on with things here, sprinting forward. So the match is underway. Hearts showing just a one change from the side which drew 1-1 with Raith Rovers at Starts Park last Saturday. Stuart Callaghan in and John Cahoon is out. Celtic, a couple of changes, Stuart Kerr in goal as we heard, and Stuart Gray is in with Brian McLaughlin dropping to the bench after last week's 1-0 win over Motherwell. Well, Brian McLaughlin certainly enjoyed some goal scoring here last season, he may yet feature this afternoon. So, a big crowd here, looking forward and anticipating a fine match. It's Peter Grant challenging Salvatore. Robertson tries to get forward. Oh, the goalkeeper's made a mistake right away. Just want to keep calm here. Well, what a start to this match for Stuart Kerr. But he gets away with it. John Robertson already causing problems. Well, Pat Bonner told the young goalkeeper just before kickoff, if you make a mistake, just keep your concentration up, don't let it get to you. It'll be interesting to see what happens. So the long kick from Gilles Rousset. Highly experienced keeper, and Hearts really look up for this at the moment. The shot going in from Colin Well, Cameron, who hit two goals against Hibs recently, sending that win in. Three goals he scored already this season.
Well, it's certainly a positive tap from Hearts. Robertson influential immediately. Busy is always giving Stuart Kerr early problems. Indication straight away with Robertson going to be a big important factor in this game, if not just through scoring in the link-up play for Hearts.
Referee, set retaken. So Stuart Kerr, just 21 years of age. Tall goalkeeper, 6'3". He's played at under 21 level. 10 caps at that level, and he has tasted first team experience, but in a testimonial match, Paul McStay's testimonial against Manchester United and friendly against Sporting Lisbon, this will be quite different this afternoon. Certainly Celtic's record under Tommy Burns here has been excellent. They took a maximum 12 points from Hearts last season in the four league matches. This is Callaghan. Challenge there by Weekhart. Cut out by Peter Grant. Good for there by McManus. It's Poynton who tried to get it forward. It's Poynton in there again. Here's the Canio, but quickly closed down. Celtic get the break of the ball here though. Stuart Gray is well challenged all the way there by Colin Cameron. Here's the Canio again. Nice touch by him. Here's Gray, stepping away from Weir first of all. And Cameron. Touch from Vikos, there's no flag here, and that's behind for the goal kick. But, both sides making early chances, and Stuart Gray taking a knock there. But De Canio and Vikos combined earlier to set up that half chance, and the Celtic player took a knock in the process.
It was a neat one too, he did ever so well. But Roussey, you can't complain about it, it's a wet surface. He simply slid into him and gave him a bang in the head with his knee, I think, or on the chin even. But it was good build-up play from Celtic, surprisingly enough today, Jerry. They went 4-3-3 Celtic today, which has surprised me. Not their usual formation, but being midfield, try to get a bit more of a solid base in midfield now and try to get a hold of it again.
So happily for Celtic, Stuart Gray has recovered. Shown by Vikost, in steps Gary Mackay. Scooped away by Stubbs. This is O'Neill. Returned by Poynton. Going behind for the goal kick. Well, Celtic have gone into this match on 19 points. Behind Rangers, and the Celtic goal difference plus 14 to plus 13 for the Ibrox club. Sent through by David Weir, player who incidentally started with the Celtic boys club before moving on to the States for a while, and then of course having a spell at Falkirk. Poynton who sends it in. Robertson's in there again, causing problems. It's Cameron. Vikost having problems there. Robertson's in there again. It's Vikost who gets it away. Positive header by McManus. Here comes De Canio now for Celtic, and Hoydonk through the middle, Simon Donnelly's arriving, so too is Peter Grant. Comes for a free kick, and it's given. And Salvatore tries to explain himself.
Yeah, he's handballed it. He's left his left arm up. Wasn't really that accidental. I think Deacon was just a bit too clever. But this isn't a real dangerous position. Van Hooydonk, as we know, can hit these balls.
Yeah, certainly the major threat again this season has Van Hooydonk. Great goal on the opening day. Great goal last week. Has to settle for the corner kick this time. But, 32 goals he scored last season, Van Hooydonk. Already this term he's hit 8. Well, the cross from Decanio, by McPherson. It's returned there by Gray. Brian O'Neill well forward also.
Oh, challenge up, you cut!
Well, Stuart Kerr certainly won't forget the opening seconds of his competitive debut. Made a mistake, but he got away with it. This is Donnelly playing it through now. It's played by David McPherson. This is McNamara. Right. It's Tom Boyd. Great. Decanio trying to pick out Boyd again, but asking a lot of him. That's out for the goal kick. So certainly spacing the midfield difficult to find. Both sides fully committed.
Yeah, I think after the cup tie where Hearts were winners on the night, they worked ever so hard and really pressed Celtic. And they played Van Hooydonk in midfield that evening. And they realised the joy they could get out of Celtic. I think Celtic acknowledging that with respect to them playing the three central midfielders all together to give them a bit of ammunition.
Vittori digs in well there. It's revived by Cost. And defending by Alan McManus. Cost. Lots of plenty of cover. It's McPherson. Slight one by Rousset. This is Vicost. Gray leaves it to Boyd. Decanio. Van Hooydonk. Again, Hearts closing their opponents down very quickly. Play that by Salvatore. So it's now gone 10 minutes here at Tynecastle. Still no scoring. So there's the recent signing, Stephen Payet. This is his home debut this afternoon. Second game, 31 years of age. And the former Bordeaux, Montpellier and a Porto player. Player of the year in France in 1989. The man has a pedigree and he's trying to rebuild his career here with Hearts. Now it's Vicost. Again, Hearts plays all around him. Breaks to Decanio. And Salvatore's in there battling. There's Peter Grant for Celtic. That's Boyd. Good play by Boyd. Early ball from him, but it falls in behind the players that mattered. Referee waves play on. This is Callaghan. And this time he gets the free kick. Well, the referee allowed what advantage there was just a moment before that. And then decided that the free kick had to be given. Jackie McNamara, the culprit. This is McManus. Paye. Clinch for handball there against Tom Boyd. Referee though allows play to go on. It's Paolo Di Canio. Three Hearts players in pursuit. And it's Hearts ball.
That's good play from Weir. He's particularly good at that. He's been a real good buy from him. The lads in the studio mentioned Rousey, who's been a good buy also. But Weir, I think he's an excellent defender.
One thing both sides will have to watch this afternoon is discipline. These two clubs have picked up 15 red cards and 51 yellow this season. But we'll just have to calm down a little bit. Hearts have had 6 red cards, 26 yellow. And Celtic have picked up 9 red cards and 25 yellow. And Tom Boyd there wrestling away with John Robertson. It's played in by Weir. This is Peter Grant. It's a poor one by him, easily picked up by Mackay. This is Payet. Salvatore. Well, the flag goes up. Looked a close call. The Hearts fans just below us, not happy with the assistant referee. Well, certainly the Hearts players
straight
into an offside position. Of course, the ruling makes it much more difficult now for the match officials. McManus. Good save by Rousey from Vikost. Well, McManus pinged that ball straight to Vikost. He reacted quickly, but so too does Gilles Rousey.
It's a fabulous strike. It's a bad, bad clearance, as you mentioned, Jerry. It's a great strike. It is a fairly comfortable because it's fairly straight on, but he does well. He punches it with great power.
Celtic again pushing forward here. Canio does well, it's Vikos with the cross. Again, Celtic have no one in there. It's close to the goalkeeper as well. It's certainly a good competitive start to the match.
Come on, who's up there?
Looks away to Peter Grant, but again, Akman Salvatore is in there. Doing a great job for Hearts. Now it's Cameron. This is Weir. Taking on Donnelly. That's ball that's quickly taken. Through for John Robertson. Well, Celtic were hesitating there. Robertson was in. Well, claims there. Well, use of an arm. Neil from the Hearts fans, but the referee was well positioned. He's not interested. Here's Stubbs for Celtic. He manages to use his power to hold off Salvatore, which is finding difficult.
Come on!
Salvatore again. Hearts ball.
Well, you might not always be guaranteed everything in football, like goals, for example, Jerry, but you can always guarantee a passionate game when you come to Hearts. Always full of effort and endeavour. If we can get some quality, which there's been a little bit of so far, then this could be a great 90 minutes.
It's Robertson again. Salvatore. It's by Gray. This is Van Hooijdonk. Vikost. Holding off the challenge of Gary Mackay. And he gets the free kick. It's up to Gary Mackay, who has enjoyed a good start to the season. The midfield has settled, but there's a clear foul there. Free kick to Celtic. And Tom Boyd is the only ever present now in the Celtic team after the suspension of Gordon Marshall. He plays it through looking for Van Hooijdonk. Let's scramble it away only as far as Vikost. This is McNamara. Di Canio's ahead of him. Di Canio against Poynton. Callaghan who goes in, makes the challenge, throw in to Celtic. This is Donnelly, De Canio, McNamara, Van Hooijdonk, and it's Cameron back defending. Victory now to Stuart Gray, Vikost. And they run into trouble. Well, John Robertson had him in trouble there, and Salvatore, who's running through, pounced as well. It's well played by Stuart Gray. Boyd. Neil puts McNamara under pressure with that one. This is Payet. Keeping possession well. It's laid off by Mackay. This is Poynton. Not sure what he was trying to achieve there, but Hearts get possession again. It's Weir. Played by Stubbs. There's Van Hooijdonk. Good touch by him, but it just falls behind the Canio. That's Cameron. Salvatore. Poynton breaks forward. Pye tries to pick him out again. Well, claims for a pass back, but the referee is waving play on. The referee waves play on. And the Hearts fans are incensed. Well, a few moments ago, they were claiming a penalty, the Hearts fans, and that occasion they claimed it was a pass back. I think, looking at it, the referee was absolutely right. The ball certainly struck the Celtic player, but he wasn't trying to really steer it back to the keeper.
No, he was in an excellent position, Jim McCluskey, give him that credit. I think it's just maybe caught the bottom of his studs, actually. And then suddenly, you know, it's meant to the keeper.
There's another chance on there for Hearts. Well, Tom Boyd was struggling there. And Stubbs had to come across and sort things out. This is Robertson. Guy tries to get through. It's away by Gray. There's Poynton. Confidence against De Canio. He's pointing with a long one forward for Robertson to chase, but asking a lot of him.
I think they'll be a little bit upset with pointing so far. He's been a little bit reckless in his passing, which is usually so good with his left foot. He's normally picking out players all the time. A little bit wild with a couple of passes.
Well, here he is challenging again with Van Hooijdonk. And again. Well, that's a good ball through this time to Robertson, who's onside. It's Robertson! The goalkeeper makes a good save. And Stubbs keeps things very calm indeed, but the ball had just drifted behind. But young Stuart Carr does ever so well against John Robertson. Great ball through from Poynton. And the goalkeeper stood up to the situation, scrambled it away.
Yeah, it's an excellent save. That is his main strength. He stands up tall. He's always based himself in Schmeichel in a way, so he's done the right thing. Great save for the kid.
A bit of pushing, jostling going on inside the penalty area. Temperature is rising out on the pitch. Jim McCluskey tries to calm things down. The pressure's still very much in Celtic here. And again, it's behind for the corner. And the Hearts fans get right behind the side. Celtic certainly knew it wouldn't be easy coming here this afternoon. That's giving a fine account of themselves. Oh, De Canio going in there, and the referee awarding the free kick. Two Hearts just outside the area. The pressure stays on Celtic. Two corners now, a free kick. Still in a dangerous position. David Weir is up there, so too is Dave McPherson. There's plenty of height for the set pieces. The goalkeeper hesitates there. He was going to come for that. He changed his mind. It goes behind for another corner.
Well, it's a dangerous cross, it's really into the danger area. I think big Pierre Van Hooijdonk does well here. Just gets it just enough away for another corner.
Goalkeeper commits himself and good handling by Stuart Kerr. Baptism of fire for this young man. And his confidence should be increasing here. He handled that well under pressure. Just before that, he made a save from Robertson. And that cancelled out his earlier mistake, which he got away with. But still, no scoring here at Tynecastle. With just over 22 minutes of the match gone. But again, Celtic have caught very square. It's Salvatore, Robertson's in the middle, it's just away from him though. What a let off for Celtic. David Weir, I think it was, who started that move, stabbing the ball through to Stefano Salvatore. And he tried to play it through for Robertson. There's Weir playing it through. Celtic caught absolutely square. Robertson right through the middle there, but the pass going beyond him. Tommy Burns will be a bit concerned over the past 5 minutes or so. It's really pressuring his defence, getting good passes through and also winning set pieces.
Well, I think he's been working all week with his defence, because last week I watched Celtic play, Jerry. They played this dangerous game which had nearly been caught on two occasions. They push up to play offside when there's no pressure on, the man has a ball. And they're going to get caught out eventually if they don't get it right.
Occasion the offside flag went up against John Robertson. Flag went up immediately. But this is a man Celtic will have to watch ever so carefully. He's hit 14 league goals against him in the past 14 years or so. This is Di Canio. Slaps him down. Cameron battling well. Stubbs has plenty of time here. There's Van Hooijdonk. Donnelly. Van Hooijdonk again. Again, the Hearts players closing down quickly. Salvatore, this is Cameron. It's Donnelly who gets back to get a foot in. But, Jim Jeffries has done quite a remarkable job here in the short time he's been at Tynecastle. And even after the rather sad cup final defeat for Hearts, they've really pulled together again. He's brought in more players, he's got a tremendous spirit about the place. Here comes Celtic though, it's McNamara, but in the end it's disappointing. Really, Charlie, in a very low budget, you look through the Hearts squad now, and he really has performed miracles.
Yeah, there's terms that they come across and people say he's better been lucky than good, but I think this man can be a bit of both for Hearts. He's been very shrewd, he's brought in players, he's got a very fine balance in his team now, considering the injuries he does have. In a small budget, you quite rightly say, but I think there's something lucky about Jim Jeffries, and I think Hearts are going to get the benefits.
Of course, they have a League Cup semi-final coming up, but at the moment it's about league points, and here comes Celtic through Simon Donnelly. V. Costa's got well forward, the ball drops in behind him though. Once again, it's Cameron back doing some defending. Here's Boyd for Celtic. It's a slight play. Throw in two Hearts. By Robertson, and the Hearts fans and Robertson claiming that he was impeded. There was no reaction from the assistant referee, who's well enough position. Here's Mackay, makes away to Di Canio. Again, Hearts showing lots of commitment, but so too does Di Canio. Again, there are three Hearts players giving chase. And once again, it was Salvatore who got possession. The header from Stubbs. Donnelly, Van Hooijdonk. Donnelly again, free kick. Well, Simon Donnelly there was in deep conversation with Tommy Burns just about half an hour before kick-off. The two of them out on the pitch, and Tommy Burns was giving him plenty of instruction. He's been playing in several different positions of late. Celtic still wondering what his best position is, but he's got them now. A free kick just outside the area, and it's a type of distance Van Hooijdonk really enjoys. Another test coming up for Gilles Rousset. So Van Hooijdonk looking for goal number 9 of the season. It's a good effort. Here's Vikost into the side netting. Once again, Rousset is there to rest your hearts. An awkward bounce perhaps in front of him. Got down to it well, knocked it away, and Vikost was following up.
He's went mainly for the accuracy in the far court, post there. It's a decent save, and then it's a hard line. It just bounced too high for Vikost. It was a clumsy challenge from Dave McPherson, which starts up. It can certainly give Celtic the initiative again.
It's played through by Peter Grant, who was caught there. This is Cameron. Weir sends it through. It's just beyond Paye. Kenia comes in to challenge. Well, Peter Grant tried to thread that one through. A little bit of slackness by the goalkeeper. Meanwhile, the free kick has been awarded against Peter Grant. But Rousset had plenty of time there, and as De Canio come in, headed against him, almost set up a chance for Peter Grant. Again, the offside flag is up against Robertson. The referee, though, allows play to go on after acknowledging the signal. It's Van Hooijdonk. Vikost. Hooijdonk again, Donnelly, by McManus, in there for Hearts on this occasion. So just coming up for 30 minutes of this match at Tynecastle, Hearts 0, Celtic 0. Here's De Canio. Good challenge there by Colin Cameron, and it had to be with Stuart Gray coming thundering in on the left side of the penalty area. So Neil Poynton, former Man City, Oldham and Everton player, struck a very good ball through to John Robertson earlier. There's De Canio trying to get forward now. He was allowed to get in his effort, despite the attentions of David McPherson and David Weir. But, under that one, and over the bar.
Yeah, it's a good effort, it's good skill. Initially, you've got to take it early because, again, of the surface, but he's unlucky with it. You just feel that Hearts, although they have the initiative in the game at the moment, they're looking more of a balanced side than Celtic at this present time. They still always carry that threat, Celtic, and you can't afford to give slack the defensive opportunities to Celtic or free kicks in dangerous areas.
This is Cameron. McManus. Oh, Simon Donnelly forced him into that. Here's Donnelly again. Vikost. Van Hooijdonk has a couple of Hearts players on him. Very difficult for Celtic's midfield to get anything through to the strikers. We'll quickly close down, but here's Van Hooijdonk again. Almost a good ball through to Stuart Gray. It breaks away to Boyd. Here's De Canio. Boyd again. Salvatore comes to meet him. Cross from him is away by McPherson. Only as far as Vikost. Good touch by him to Van Hooijdonk. Celtic have plenty of players forward here. It's Gray who's there. put behind for the goal kick. Well, Celtic have won 3 of the last 5 league games here. Had a draw also, and 1 defeat, losing to a John Robertson goal a couple of years ago. And of course, John Robertson got the winner in the recent League Cup tie. Free kick to Hearts, long ball. This is Weir. Well, that's a good ball. Chance on here. Well, Paye was way at the far side. And the Celtic defence in real trouble there. The goalkeeper did get a touch on it. This time it's Mackay who sends it in. Well, that came off David McPherson. And behind for the goal kick.
Well, there's 2 or 3 opportunities, and McPherson probably was a bit worried about Stubbs coming through and taking a full challenge. But just before that, the second time Celtic have been caught with diagonal balls at the back post, Stuart Kerr's done the only thing he could have done there, because he's full stretch to knock it back out, and he's fortunate Celtic can clear it. But Celtic defensively still not managing to pick up the Hearts forwards properly.
The problem here, but David Weir responded well against the Canio. Nice touch through from Van Hooydonk. Well, this is a fixture which does provide a lot of goals. There's just one goalless draw in the 34 Premier Division matches. Games played here over many years. And Jackie McNamara there will just have to be very careful. Going in high there, and Hearts have themselves another free kick. Celtic getting themselves sorted out here. Certainly solidly struck. And Salvatore, still Hearts have it through Cameron. That takes a deflection. And Celtic all over the place, it's Poynton. Chance down by Vikost and O'Neill. Now it's Weir, Hearts keep the pressure on here. Dilich Weir comes off Peter Grant for the corner kick. Well, Weir is claiming it struck the arm of Peter Grant, but the ball was driven against him. Person's up there challenging. The Stubbs who got it away. Just got in front of Weir. Stubbs again. Chance for Celtic to break. Good challenge there by Alan McManus. Donnelly trying to pick out Decanio. There was a slip from McManus earlier, but he certainly did well there. It's Hearts ball. Hearts way. This is great. Difficult one for Decanio. Same out towards Donnelly. Poynton's there though. Now it's O'Neill. Forced to backtrack. Well, Poynton does well there. The referee's allowing advantage, but there really wasn't a lot of advantage to Hearts in that situation. Poynton had handled things ever so well, getting the ball away from 2 Celtic players. it in again. This is Vic Horst. Yes, that one nearby stops. Of course, the referee can intervene now. If there's no real advantage, he can still award the free kick. And that certainly didn't get the better of that situation. This is Di Canio. Switch now to the other flank. Showing good skills. Celtic take the lead. Van Hooijdonk. 37 minutes gone here at Tynecastle. And after a lot of harsh pressure, it's Pierre Van Hooijdonk for Celtic. Well, good play on the right-hand side by Paolo Di Canio. Cut it back. Was nicely left by Simon Donnelly, and Van Hooijdonk picked his spot.
Yeah, well, Hearts have only got themselves to blame. It's bad defending, there's no protection for pointing. A great step over from Donnelly, and Van Hooijdonk doesn't miss him. Hearts should really have the initiative in this game. But the two or three occasions, Celtic have looked as if they can get goals, and it's proved the case now.
Pierre Van Hooijdonk can put his troubles behind them in terms of the contract situation with Celtic. He scored the winner last week in injury time against Motherwell. He gives Celtic the lead this afternoon and gives them hope that they can go top of the Premier Division this afternoon. They held that position for just 1 week last season. But Hearts will fight on here. It was really a bit of a sucker punch for them after a number of set pieces. And here's Di Canio on the other side of the field now. Good ball by him to Vic Horst. He's trying to pick out McNamara. Just over 5 minutes until the interval was any stoppage time. Celtic lead by 1-0. This is Van Hooijdonk being challenged by McPherson. It's through by Grant. This is Vic Horst looking for Simon Donnelly. That's a good ball. Di Canio's in the middle. Gray's coming in as well, but Cameron defends that situation well. Colin Cameron made up ground there against Stuart Gray. Celtic have the corner. Stubbs is well forward. It's played short though. Canio and Donnelly. Advantage played, but not taken.
Well, credit to Simon Donnelly. He could have made a meal of it and got the player probably booked, which probably merited it anyway, but credit to the young fella just getting up and trying to get his shot on target.
By Van Hooijdonk. Donnelly. Grant. Good play by Grant. This is Boyd. That's great. Di Canio. Boyd again. Again, Celtic have plenty of players forward. Peter Grant again digging in well then against Robertson. Peter Grant in his 14th season now with Celtic, his testimonial season, taking a knock there. This is Van Hooijdonk. Quickly closed down, he does well to retain possession. It's Grant. It's off Van Hooijdonk. This is Cameron. Good ball through for Robertson. And he was through the middle. Here's Robertson again. Stuart Callaghan had battled hard to keep possession there for Hearts, then he left it to John Robertson, but well wide with the effort.
Not always Robbo's favourite distance, we're so used to seeing him cutting them in from 4 or 5 yards. A good play from young Callaghan, and it's a bit wild, he didn't get any bend in it to bring it back into the back post. So good play from Hearts.
Be feeling a bit sore if they don't get something back quickly. So time running away from them this first half. The offside flag has gone up on the far side. Yeah, Simon Donnelly has come more and more into this match. They simply stepped over the ball nicely as DiCanio cut it back, leaving it to Pierre Van Hooydonk for the only goal of the match. Decision goes Hearts way. So a chance here now for Hearts. Push the tall players forward, but Ferson's up there, so too is Weir. Right over the goalkeeper. Salvatore drives it in. It breaks away now to Gary Mackay. Come on, there's Weir. Past the post. David Weir so unlucky there. The ball was driven across. Just inches away.
Decent ball across the goal, he just doesn't catch it properly. Nice cutback. He should just be sticking that in the back of the net.
So we're inside the final minute. First half, Celtic lead by 1-0. It's Simon Donnelly. Grant tries to thread it through in the direction of Vikos, but it's a pointer now for Hearts. Well, the offside flag is up, and a very close one indeed. Graham Kerr from Dundee, the linesman just below us. Putting the flag up immediately. Meanwhile, it's Weir clearing for Hearts. In comes Peter Grant for Celtic. Recovered now by Cannon, but good challenge by Boyd. We're now into stoppage time in this first half. And Jim Jeffries, Charlie must be
very
wondering what happened there.
Yes, his team were playing without being outstandingly good. They had the better of Celtic, they were more determined looking than Celtic, certainly better organised. They've had chances, they haven't taken them and have been punished for that. And he will be very disappointed with the scoreline at half-time.
Did well to keep that in play and find Weir, but well, the linesman has indicated, and the assistant referee, as we have told to call him these days, indicated that was out of play. He really is getting a hard time there from the Hearts fans alongside him. This is Boyd, Gray, DiCanio, Boyd again, Donnelly, DiCanio, down he goes, play on, says the referee. Salvatore is chasing a referee, saying he wants a Celtic player booked. But Jim McCluskey immediately waved play on. DiCanio trying to explain the situation to Rousset as he comes back onto the field. There's absolute bedlam here. By Weir, it's a good ball to Cameron. We're well inside stoppage time here. And again, John Robertson causes a threat. The corner kick is awarded. Cameron did well to keep that in play and provided the cross. Robertson was in there. Ball was deflected behind. And Hearts pull it back. 2 minutes of stoppage time played. This is Gary Mackay. Callahan. Big scramble it clear. It's picked up by Canio. The whistle sounds at the end of a dramatic half. And once again, Celtic can thank Pierre Van Hooydonk. He struck after 37 minutes. Good play on the right-hand side by De Canio. Simon Donnelly stepped over the ball and Van Hooydonk placed it beyond Rousset. At Tynecastle, it's Hearts 0, Celtic 1.
Yes, entertaining stuff, all right. That's the story of the first half. Hearts 0, Celtic 1, as Jerry says. The views of Craig Levine and Jim Traynor on the key moments, and there are plenty at Tynecastle after this short break.
British Airways looks after the hopes and dreams of 30 million people. British Airways, the world's favourite airline.
Now your Evening Times really puts more life and soul into every day of your week. More sport, more fun, more for women, more for everyone. More jobs every Monday, more homes every Tuesday, more sport every Wednesday, more to do every Thursday. Plus, there's even more big prize competitions, like our £20,000 Game of Two Halves every Friday and Saturday. Put more life and soul into your week with the Evening Times.
S'il vous plaît, le chemin est long et ma roue est cassée.
Monsieur, ma vache est prête à veiller, mais le veau est mal engagé.
Comment vous remercier?
Oh, une bière pour monsieur, s'il vous plaît.
Une Stella Artois.
Et la monnaie?
If you're looking for new frames, where can you choose from hundreds and hundreds at half price at Boots Opticians?
Ma'am, we believe your father has become a slavering, ravenous wolf.
But you'll not find him here. Not when urge is upon him.
He'll be out roaming villages hereabouts.
Ring him if you like. He's got a mobile.
He's got a mobile.
No, he must be caught and committed.
Oh, he don't like commitment. That's why he's on the new Vodafone prepay scheme.
Aye, no monthly bills.
He pays for all his calls up front at post office.
You're not tied up to a contract, were you?
It's champion.
Aye, champion!
Enough of Vodafone prepay schemes. This horror must end.
Bit harsh, isn't it? Just because an old man's fancy turns to younger women.
Oh, hello.
Well, just have to keep on looking.
Aye, champion.
The Vodafone prepay scheme. You are not alone.
Hi, I'm here to promote the special edition Corsa Vegas, but I got carried away and blew the budget. So I've persuaded Jeff here to film me with his camcorder. That's enough, Jeff. I'm so sorry, Vauxhall. I love the Corsa. I can still do it. Action! The gorgeous Corsa Vegas comes with £700 worth of extras free, including central locking and sunroof, the board. The Corsa Vegas from Vauxhall, the small car with a big personality.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back. A good first half, and it's 1-0 Celtic. Craig, your lads have got it all to do if they're going to win this one.
Well, I don't know about that. I think if we carry on playing the way that we've played in the first half and take a couple of chances, then I think we can win the game.
Yeah.
I don't think we're by any means out of it.
Well, chances galore in that first 45 minutes, Jim, and Van Hooijdonk certainly took his, and a good dummy from Simon Donnelly to set him up.
It's very clever. Donnelly did well there. De Canio, he's always liable to do that, but Donnelly was very sharp, very aware. But Van Hooijdonk's just stepped off Weir. Weir's allowed him the space here. There's no challenge. You see, he's just stepped off him,
yeah.
Sweeps it into the net. It's a good goal, but it's a bad goal from Hart's point of view.
Yeah,
especially Weir.
There, Craig. Yeah, Jim's got a point.
Yeah, it's a good move by Pierre Van Hooijdonk. He's just drifted off David there. I think David's just been caught watching the ball at a vital moment, and that's a good finish. If you give him a chance in there, he'll finish it.
What about Stuart Kerr, Craig? A bit of a nervy start for him at the beginning. I'm not quite sure what he was thinking of. His mind was elsewhere.
Yeah, it was exactly what he didn't want. The ball played back to him and Robbo charging it down. And that's exactly what happened. I thought he was a little bit slack here. I think he should have been right onto the ball and picking it up.
Yeah,
I don't John think just about got back to him there.
He didn't notice Robertson behind him.
No, he didn't look fully aware, and it was either maybe he was trying to calm the situation, say, well, look, I've got this under control,
that's
but
what
he almost
like,
made
Jim,
a mess of it again.
Yeah.
Robertson's too sharp to do that with a player like that. I don't think that the keeper was fully aware Robertson was there.
Robertson's been throwing plenty at Kerr throughout that first half, Jim, but to be fair, the goalkeeper has stood up well to it. I mean, after that, he redeemed himself.
Yeah, I thought Hearts maybe should have punished them almost immediately. But here, John Robertson should have done better there, I thought, you know, for a striker of his calibre. But the keeper certainly did well, and that gives him confidence.
Yeah.
He gets down well, knocks it away in this corner. He takes this corner well, I believe.
Yeah.
Under pressure, took it well. So you can see that his confidence is building up. But I still think that Hearts should have... They're very unfortunate to be behind because they had the greater number of chances, I thought.
Yeah, I mean, Hearts are doing the right thing. They're bombarding Stuart Kerr when they can, aren't they, Craig? And,
yeah,
and Kerr is doing all right.
I think that after that initial mistake, I think the Celtic keeper did very well. But I think if we continue to play and if Celtic continue to try and catch us offside, well, there's another good save there. If Celtic continue to try and catch us offside, I noted a point that Charlie made earlier on about the player who's in possession not being pressured, and that's what's happening. Celtic aren't pressuring their midfield players when they've got the ball and they're still trying to play offside.
That might change then. Well, don't forget, you can vote for this afternoon's Bells Man of the Match by dialling 0891 66 5520. That's 0891 66 5520. The lines are open from now to just before full time for the Bells Man of the Match. Time for another quick break. We're back in a couple of minutes.
She's just printed a garden plan. She can, you can, Canon printers can.
There's a revolution coming to Scottish broadcasting. From the 1st of November, tune in to Sky Scottish. For details, phone 0990 979797 or contact your local cable operator.
Mom and Dad are back.
Peugeot, the drive of your life.
Need to paint where a brush won't reach? Plasti-coated. Paint that's safe and very tough. Plasti-coated. A paint that can really take the heat. Plasti-coated. A paint that helps fight rust beautifully. Plasti-coat. It makes painting easy.
For BT friends and family members, here's another great offer. Get hooked up to Sky TV by December the 31st and you get 10% off the normal price. That's nearly 60 quid. And every month you get 5.5 hours of free local calls at the weekend. You also get all of this. Interested? Call 0800 800 892 now.
It's coming to Scotland for the first time ever. It's the Heineken Cup and European Rugby Conference. The most exciting events to burst onto the rugby scene since the Rugby World Cup. Representing Scotland will be Edinburgh, Glasgow, the Scottish Borders and the Caledonia Reds. So come along and support your local heroes.
Welcome back. It's 1-0 Celtic at Tynecastle. Craig, do you see it changing? You want it to change?
Yeah, I do see it change. I think there'll be more goals. And I think if we continue to create chances, we'll get goals.
What do you think, Jim?
I think so. I think that Celtic's defence in particular has to tighten up. They're very, very shaky. They don't seem to have got the system right. They've had that problem all season. It's still here today.
It's entertaining stuff, isn't it?
It's very good. There's chances at both ends. But I think Hearts have had, as I said earlier, the greater number of chances. And they're very unfortunate to be behind.
Yeah. Craig, you fancy someone to do it for the Hearts.
Yeah, I think
stick
we'll
one
score
in early.
The big danger is that we pile forward and lose a second goal. And I'm hoping we don't do that.
And of course, if it stays this way, Celtic are top. And Celtic supporters will be chuffed about that.
We'll talk about that at the end.
They've waited long enough for this, Jim, haven't they?
I mean, they'll take a great deal from that if they're ahead at the end of the game. But I think Hearts shouldn't hold back now. I think they've got to go for it because it's a shaky defence.
Yes, indeed. OK, well, it's 1-0 Celtic, as we're saying. It's thoroughly entertaining. Let's rejoin Jerry McNee at Tynecastle. Jerry.
Thanks, Jim. So the Hearts team coming back to the field. Hearts are unbeaten here in the league this season, beating Kilmarnock and Dundee United and drawing with Motherwell. In addition, Hearts have beaten both Stenismuir and Celtic in the League Cup. And of course, the draw with Red Star Belgrade. But, they need to improve their scoring record against Celtic here. There's 6 goals in the last 9 games. I'm sure Jim Jeffries has them well wound up for this second half. Last league defeat here, in fact, was way back in March when they lost that remarkable match 5-2 to Partick Thistle. And the 3 defeats this season have all come away at Pittodrie, East End Park and Ibrox. So Celtic led out again by Peter Grant. Well, Charlie, the message from Jim Jeffries.
Yeah, I think it'll be more of the same. They've played well at times, they've made opportunities. Unfortunately for them, they haven't taken them. I believe it was the champ back in the studio. I think it's been a case that Hearts have probably been the better team. But Celtic will always be a threat. If you don't defend properly, you don't concentrate on them, the Canio will create something, and Pierre Van Hooydonk, which he has already done, will take the opportunities. And Celtic will always be that type of side.
So referee Jim McCluskey checks with the assistants, and away we go for this second half here at Tynecastle. Celtic leading by Pierre Van Hooydonk's goal after 37 minutes. And immediately the offside flag goes up. So now the manager wishing to make a change at the interval. Parts of Paul Ritchie, Pasquale Bruno and Darren Bickford on the bench. Celtic of Malcolm Mackay, Andreas Thom and Brian McLaughlin. through towards Callaghan. Here's Van Hooydonk. Wicks away from him though, to Salvatore. Here's McPherson, who's well forward. And offside flag is up. On the far side, Stuart Callaghan was not amused.
I think he's got it wrong there, Jerry. I think the young fella's just timed his run. I think it's Alan Stubbs to slow out.
Robertson challenges. Sorry by Boyd. Salvatore again. Covering a lot of this Tynecastle pitch. This is Cameron. Gary Mackay does well. The goalkeeper makes a good save. It's McNamara who gets the touch, and Grant. And away by Tom Boyd. What a super bust through the Celtic defence here from Gary Mackay. He did really well, but so too did Stuart Carr. Here comes Celtic now. The offside flag is up as De Canio goes through. Some very close decisions in this match. We saw one at the other end just a moment or so ago that went against Hearts. This is Poynter. So Neil for Celtic. Van Hooydonk. Touched by him to Donnelly, but breaks away from him. This is Weir. Off John Robertson and out for the throw to Celtic.
Neil Poynton just changing his top, I think, after a little tug there with Simon Donnelly there on, Jerry. Actually, a good bit of play just before that with David Weir, just cutting inside De Canio, and John Robertson trying to flick. But actually, if he had controlled it on his own, he possibly could have been in and goal.
O'Neill looking for Donnelly. Good ball. Two young players battling away. And it's hard to get the decision.
He's backtracked well. He looked at for a minute as if he was going to lose out to Simon Donnelly, but he was persistent. He did ever so well to get Hearts out of trouble.
Van Hooydonk. Mackay challenges with Robertson. Now that's handball. Handball from Paye. It's quite clear. Here's Donnelly now for Celtic. Vittori tries to challenge. De Canio calls for it. Yeah, that's a good job there. Cameron, we are closing them down, but Celtic have possession again. It's a Stuart Gray out to Boyd. Again, Celtic have plenty of players forward. So towards Vikos, who gets a touch on it. It comes off Boyd, then Van Huydel. Said in the studio at halftime, we expected more goals. We haven't had long to wait. Salvatore lays it off. It's played through by Weir. The offside flag is up. Free kick is awarded to Jim Jeffries there. Must really have wondered what was happening when it went to 2-0. But Hearts are right back into it. Two from Van Hooydonk for Celtic, one from Cameron for Hearts. It's Celtic pushing forward again. He's just away from Stuart Gray. Tony Burns looks on. He tries to sort things out, but he can't be over happy with his defence this afternoon. Here's De Canio. Vikos makes a good run. Still it's Vikos, twisting and turning. The goalkeeper got a touch on it. It's behind for the corner. Oh, good play by Vikos. The Rousey did just enough. Paolo Di Canio to take this one. Simon Donnelly makes himself available. Picks it short. It's Di Canio again. Went towards Peter Grant. Poynton tries to get it away. Grant's there again. He's challenged by Callaghan. That's a free kick, surely, against Peter Grant. The referee's showing a fair bit of tolerance.
Yeah, I think young Callaghan's just been clever. He's let it just run a little bit further than what Peter Grant was expecting. And he's followed through with some momentum and really taken him down. Certainly Hearts really now back in the game. Must feel there's opportunities there for them.
Well, play is still going on, despite the fact that Stephen Pye is on the ground. This is McManus. He's the only Hearts player who's on the deck. The referee's had a look over towards him. He's getting back to his feet now as play continues. Torre tries to play it through and the free kick is awarded. Well, I just wonder how long Jim McCluskey will wait before producing the yellow card here. But Pai is back on his feet and he was caught. But certainly he looks to have made a bit of a meal of that as he was challenged by Brian O'Neill. match underway again. Cameron plays it wide to Weir. This is Stubbs. Stubbs again. Van Hooydonk. Out for De Canio. He controls it well. Again, so they're getting players forward here. It's De Canio trying to lay it off. But it's away by Hearts. Done by Boy to fix the pass from Peter Grant. And Pierre Van Hooydonk lifts into an offside position. And no complaints about that one. Stefan Paye, who's still receiving some treatment, has come back on. Solid challenge there from O'Neill. Done by McPherson. Going on between Simon Donnelly and Stuart Callaghan. And also between Van Hooydonk and McPherson. This is O'Neill. Good running by McNamara on the right, but the pass a little overhit there, making it difficult for him, but the player does well. And it's David McPherson who drops it behind for the corner kick, but that was excellent running onto that pass by Jackie McNamara. Neil and Stubbs have moved forward as the corner's delivered. This is John Robertson battling for it with McNamara. It's Mackay. Long one out towards Cameron. So there's too much pace in it. And Peter Grant's pointing out towards the assistant referee, who felt that perhaps Cameron was in an offside position. And Van Hooydonk is again. Well, Donnelly looks for the free kick after the challenge by Poynton, but the referee shakes his head. It's Poynton again. Aimless ball.
I really think he's looking for John Robertson and Pye to make a combination run and, as in a changeover run. They're not really giving him any movement, and suddenly he's just got an area to hit it into, and at least one of them's got to make the attempt to get there.
Watches this one carefully. This is Vikost. Boyd. Looking for De Canio. It's Boyd again. He does well. He keeps his run going. This is De Canio. Through now for Boyd, but the offside flag is up. This time it's Boyd who complains. And it's another close one. It's up a little level. A little bit of controversy over these side decisions. Here come Hearts now through Callaghan. Good effort by him! Goal kick. Well, it certainly wasn't far away. He cut inside and let fly. Stuart Kerr was at full stretch and the ball dipped just over.
Yeah, it was nice. Nice to see a young man taking responsibility like that. Not his favoured foot, but still, he's just got it just maybe a yard or so just too high. A great individual skill.
Free kick is awarded. David McPherson impeded there by Van Hooydonk. play it. Here's Van Hooijdonk. Well, challenged up by McManus. Starts ball, indicates the referee. Carefully by Boyd. This is great. Well, that's Blair's clipping offside, and then the flag went up. Well, I'm afraid the assistant referee, just was Graham Kerr from Dundee, is having a rather unhappy afternoon. Stubbs through for Vikost. Oh, it's Decanio. On a kick. So again, Celtic push players forward. This is Decanio. Floated in by Donnelly, another chance on here. And over the top from O'Neill.
Well, that was a great opportunity. A lovely little chip in from Simon Donnelly. I think big Brian O'Neill will be really disappointed. He just gets under it, but his timing I don't think was right there.
So Hearts are getting ready to make a change. So Salvatore is going off, who's had an excellent match. Pasquale Bruno is the man coming on. So the player from AC Milan, Fiorentina and Atalanta goes off, Salvatore. And Pasquale Bruno, who spent time at Torino, Fiorentina and Juventus, comes on to a great welcome from the Hearts fans. Carson's header, touch on Vikost, here he is again. I was trying to find Decanio. Real misunderstanding there.
He's trying to force the pass. I think we've seen a demonstration of that during the week in Amsterdam, where you're sitting watching a patient passing game, and eventually something will open up, and that's an example of what happens in our country.
As we are playing it through, the flag is up though. It's 20 minutes of the second half gone. Celtic are leading by 2-1. Two from Van Hooijdonk. Cameron getting one back for Hearts. Free kick is awarded against Vikost. Foul on Paillet. By Poynton, the keeper commits himself, picks it comfortably. This is O'Neill. It's a good ball through for Di Canio. He timed his run perfectly, still it's Di Canio. Well, Simon Donnelly was coming in on the far side. A superb run by Di Canio. Just beyond the far post.
It's a particularly difficult angle with the left footer. To get good pace in it and beat the goalkeeper. And as you see, as he lines it up, his first touch is decent. Then he's cut across it with his left foot. And it's very difficult to place it in off the post from there.
As Donnelly does well. Takes a return from Van Hooijdonk. Peter Grant sending it wide left. There's some more from Stuart Gray. Always a difficult ball out towards him. He was trying to keep an eye on it and lost his footing. To Celtic. And Celtic's away record has been highly impressive. Just one defeat in 18 months, and that was the recent one to Rangers at Ibrox. And again this afternoon, they're in the driving seat, leading by 2-1. There's Di Canio, trying to turn him a bit of style. It's Van Hooijdonk. Boyd. Now it's Gray providing the cross. Poynton got the touch. Callan recovered well there. This is Bruno. Shocker from him.
I think that was a defender's pass. Not really being aware that Robertson had peeled off nice. We've seen the run from Cameron, but he must have the patience.
And Hooijdonk gets a touch there to Di Canio. Through now by Donnelly, it's Di Canio again. Donnelly battles well. This is McNamara, Di Canio. Well, the standard of the passing. Getting worse as this second half progresses. McManus. Well, we'll see what the Hearts manager thinks about it. So, well, it was a feature of much of the match at Ibrox yesterday. A lot of poor passing by both sides. It's certainly keeping in here, but Van Hooijdonk now trying to get through for Celtic onto the pass from Vikos.
Part of that problem also, Jerry, which I watched yesterday too, was when the player on the ball, especially in the wide positions, get the ball, all the midfield players run right on top of the forward, so we don't have anything like movement, and it may end up knocking these big, long, diagonal balls. And there's the other example. It's always difficult now. They play the game, the long, diagonal balls, it's making the game easy for everybody at the back. You want to try and at least pass through your midfield.
Svikost, Van Hooijdonk. Again, it all breaks down. There's little cohesion from the other side. And there's Robertson coming in now, but Stuart Kerr takes the responsibility. Through to Boyd. The run was matched by Alan McManus. And a good challenge from him. This time it's David Weir. Van Hooijdonk. It's McPherson who intercepts. That's a breaking forward here, getting cleared up the field. And, Celtic have managed to get back as Callaghan sends in another long ball. Same old story. Again, the passing out of defence here, the pass from McPherson, who'd made a good break, made it difficult for Callaghan. And that allowed Celtic time to get back and left him with a little option. Well, Van Hooijdonk is straight into an offside position. Some activity over at the Hearts bench, they're contemplating another change as play goes on. This is Vikost. Donnelly. Canio is just ahead of him. Canio trying to find a way through. But it's David McPherson. Again, he's slack with it. Now Bruno's caught, and it's DiCanio. This is Gray, Tom Boyd comes in support. This is Boyd, delivering the cross. Well, McPherson left it there, and it almost broke to Vikost. And both sides really toiling at the moment. A lot of mistakes are being made. Hearts are about to send on Darren Beckford, and he's certainly a player who could cause us Celtic defence problems. It's Gary Mackay who's going off. Well, Beckford is certainly a physical player. He arrived here on a short-term deal from Oldham. He's got a couple of hat-tricks in the reserves. Push him up front in the hope of getting themselves right back into contention here. That one's beyond and behind for the goal kick. Celtic are about to make a change also. Andreas Thom is preparing to come on, as you can see. Bruno winning that one. Well, Callaghan took his eye off the ball, but Hearts have got it back again through Poynton. Good defending by Stubbs. This is Stubbs again. Peter Grant. Off by Van Hooijdonk. This is Vikost, McNamara. Van Hooijdonk. Donnelly's there with Poynton. Ball still in play. Rips away now to McNamara. Donnelly did well there. McNamara loses out to Pasquale Bruno. This is Payet. A good crossfield pass into the path of David Weir. The offside flag is up though. Well, Robertson and Pye and Beckford were all running forward.
John Robertson.
And Robertson was off there. No doubt about that. That's 75 minutes gone. Celtic lead by 2-1. Simon Donnelly is leaving the field. They've been replaced by Andreas Thom. Who's recovering from injury. He already has 6 goals this season, Andreas Thom. For Celtic, just over £2 million from Bayer Leverkusen. Had an excellent season last season. So he gets a huge ovation from the Celtic fans. And, not from the Hearts ones, obviously. One forward looking for Van Hooijdonk. This is Vikost. Thom. Through for DiCanio. Gray's on the far side. Challenged by Cameron, the man who got Hart's goal. Celtic's ball. Carrier's on the far side. Poynton gets a touch though. Callaghan's there. This is Payet. Callaghan again. He's given away to Vikhorst. This is McNamara. Tom. De Canio. That's Payet. Bruno. Free kick. Showing a bit of dissent, but Jim McCluskey has handled this match firmly and fairly. Well, absolutely no challenge there. Stuart Kerr advanced for that one. He was able to take it comfortably. He'll be a happy young man if Celtic can hang on to this scoreline or even add to it in his competitive debut. Again, Paye plays it through. That's a good ball, finding Cameron. It's behind for the corner. Well, Stephen Paye has hit some nice passes. Well, those around him doing so well. So McPherson has moved forward, so too has Weir. Goal kick off the head of Stephen Paye.
Yeah, it looks a promising player, Paye. He's his head. He's got nice touch, which we would expect, but he's got good vision in the game. I don't know if the up front in Scotland will be probably his most suitable position. I think he looks capable of linking up with players, and he looks quite promising for Hearts.
This is Poynton. Looking for Beckford. Sorry, Grant for Celtic. Pursued by Bruno, who makes a good challenge, and he provides a cross. O'Neill who got the touch, Robertson's in there. Well, Robertson's clearing, use of an arm by Boyd. The referee's not interested. Again, Beckford, it's there, gets the touch. Again, the goalkeeper, Stuart Kerr, has a real problem. Bruno, pursued by Grant. Another wasted ball by Stuart Callaghan. Almost too much pace in that one though for De Canio. So Celtic preparing to make another change. Brian McLaughlin, who scored his first ever goal for Celtic at this ground last season, in fact, he managed a double that day. So Vikhorst leaves the field. Well, there's no slackness, and the ball's given away again.
Even the goalkeepers are at it now.
Sheldon Roussey there with a desperate ball. It's played through by Gray. Again, the one there. the goalkeeper certainly taking his time about that there. In recent matches, time's been added on against Celtic Wheeling. They've gone on to score in stoppage time. Well, the offside flag is up again. Remember the match at Tannadice, the referee just kept indicating to Celtic as they were down to 10 men on that occasion, he'd add on time, and what did they do? They scored right at the death, and last week there was time added on again after the goalkeeper was ordered off. There's maybe a chance on now for Cameron. Had it on the run. Again, it's Paye putting a good ball over.
Yes, a superb crossfield pass. He possibly could have took it in his chest. He went in and goal. He decided to go for the volley, but an awkward angle for the volley, but a great pass.
So it's Van Hooydonk. Andreas Tom. It's now for McLaughlin to Boyd. Gray, De Canio. It's McLaughlin. So that helps ball. It's a good one forward, a difficult one. And O'Neill dealt with that well because Paye was heading right into the penalty area. And the flag is up against De Canio. Oh, there's a mistake there. Well, O'Neill, who did so well just a moment ago, slipped up. Fortunately for him, Stubbs was there with Robertson. This is Callaghan, stepping away from Grant. Weir's in a bit of space. This is David Weir. It's Grant to make the challenge. Free kick, two hearts against McLaughlin, the foul on Weir. Out about that one. Just under 6 minutes left plus stoppage time. Free kick to Hearts. Right at the goalkeeper. Another wasted opportunity. Well, after such a good first half, Hearts have been disappointing. The second half. Once again, the ball drops beyond the ball. It's a goal kick. 5 minutes left here at Tynecastle. It's Hearts 1, Celtic 2, 2 goals from Pierre Van Hooydonk. One from Colin Cameron. A touch. Beckford and Bruno were both involved there as Point and sent it in. Beckford got the initial touch and then Bruno was there, but nothing came of it. And the referee is indicating that he will add on time because of time wasting by Stuart Kerr. person goes forward. So towards Weir. Second half. In fact, they've won just one of the last five league games. At least a 3-1 win over Hibs. Yet again, Canio is caught.
I think the disappointment mainly in the way that his team played in the first half. Couldn't get a goal and then they suddenly get themselves a lifeline second half. But they haven't played at all. Celtic haven't played that well either, but they simply took two chances.
This is McLaughlin. Out for Andreas Thom. This is Gray. Boyd. Canio. Thom again, back to the Canio. Good run by him, this could finish it. The interception was there from David McPherson. Andreas Thom was just about to pounce on that one. Now McNamara does well. Leaves it to Van Hooijdonk. Again, Beckford's up there. So we're inside the final minute of the match. Celtic's way. There's a bit of anger being shown there. He just pans it down. Some viewers this afternoon have voted Pierre Van Hooijdonk man of the match for his two goals, but there might be further drama to come here. Now in stoppage time. McPherson's there!
Chance.
So Dave McPherson With two spells with Rangers, he's now in his second spell with Hearts. Gets equaliser. Played almost 2 minutes of stoppage time. The referee indicated he would add on time because of time wasting by Stuart Kerr. Well, Tommy Burns knows that Celtic had opportunities like this last season to go top, and they failed. And it might be again that will be the case. But you never rule out this Celtic side until the whistle is sounded. They get so many late goals. Replay, some tempers are being shown. The flag was up on the far side. Meanwhile, Celtic are breaking. This is Di Canio. It's just beyond McLaughlin. So we've played over 3 minutes of stoppage time. Now Hearts are in no hurry to get on with things. It's Van Hooydonk-Kers to return the ball to Rousset. Well, there's a happier manager, no doubt about that. Certainly his team performed exceptionally well in the first half. They were caught by a sucker punch. The final whistle sounds. A dramatic afternoon here at Tynecastle. Celtic lose out on another chance. Well, Charlie Nicholas, your thoughts?
Yes, it was a disappointing second half in terms of quality. There was great effort, great fight from both teams. But it's always got to be said at the end of it, we've got to produce better than this. We've got four goals, sometimes you should be happy. Celtic have shot himself in the foot after an opportunity to go top, but Hearts will be delighted in the fact that they came back to get a 2-2 draw.
So Pierre Van Hooydonk was named the man of the match, but the Hearts fans will certainly be delighted with the contribution there of David McPherson. He certainly does his old club a real favour. But there's a long, long way to go in this championship. The Celtic fans troop off, well, disappointed and dejected because victory looked to be theirs until those dying seconds. But it's Hearts and the supporters who leave this ground happy.
So that's it. A sensational end there. A share of the points at Tynecastle. Join me again after this short break for the thoughts of Craig and Jim. More post-match reaction from Tynecastle. And remember, give us your views on the game on the forum on 0500 404 000. Don't go away.